He talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood?
In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood?
In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away. No glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Good morning. It's wonderful to see each of you in God's house this morning. Do we have a special event going on today? We had 129 in Sunday school. That is wonderful. Yes. So if you didn't come a little earlier for Sunday school today, we invite you to do that next Sunday. Even with that 129, I know there's still some vacant seats. So we encourage you to get here for Sunday school next Sunday. As we're turning to the back of our bulletin and looking for opportunities for later this week, notice some changes in the regular weekly schedule. I do have an update, a positive update on the prayer list. Of course, we want to remember those listed there. I did talk to Janet just before service started, and Miss Nellie is now at Oakwood for a couple of weeks for a little bit of recovery and recuperation. So that's good news. We always want to hear people moving out of the hospital. As we are looking at other opportunities, what will be starting tomorrow? Does anybody know? Yes, and that is the excitement Miss Karen wants to hear. We have Vacation Bible School starting tomorrow, and I think Karen is probably decorating somewhere. Oh, no, she's here. That's the first time I've seen her sitting down in 2 weeks. But we have Bible school starting tomorrow. There are registration forms in the hall. If you have not registered, there's still, somebody texted me last night and said the online link was down. Annette and I will look into that and be sure that you can still register online. But pick up a paper form, bring that back tomorrow night. We are looking for lots of fun happening here every night this week. And then I have a message from Pastor Skip. He is doing better and traveling with family. So those of you that have been remembering him in your prayers, thank you. Those are being heard and he is feeling better. Again, it's wonderful to see each of you in God's house today. We hope you're blessed by your time here and enjoy our special speaker today. And Tanya is going to come and give us a little more information. Thank you, Tanya.
Good morning. What an exciting day, and it's so great to see so many faces this morning. It is with much excitement and anticipation that we welcome to the pulpit today Reverend Michael Kohl as our pastoral candidate for Bedford Baptist Church at the recommendation of the Pastor Search Committee. We gladly welcome his family today as well, his wife Laura, his children Benaiah, Ethan, and Cara. And Reverend Kohl will lead our children's time this morning and give his testimony during Moments for Mission, and of course, preach the sermon. So I want to share a little thing with you about yesterday afternoon when we did the ice cream social. For those of you who were here, I remember John Moore said to make sure you're here at 10:53 to make sure you can hear the bio on a Reverend Michael. He was kind of holding out on you guys, and so I'm sharing the bio with you this morning. But for those of you who were not able to make it to the ice cream social, Reverend Michael shared a pretty neat trick with us in learning the Ten Commandments in order using our hands and fingers. And that really stuck with us. And he had almost 100% audience participation and lots of fun. So if you missed that, I'll just put in a little plug that maybe if you vote yes today, that you will get your opportunity to see that little trick sometime in the future. So without further ado, I'll start with the bio. When I first asked Reverend Kohl to share a short bio with us, he emailed me just that, a short bio. And I was like, well, you might need to elaborate a little bit more just so the folks here can get to know you and your family better. And so he obliged and much appreciated. So here is his extended version. Reverend Michael Kohl was born and raised by missionary parents in Ecuador, South America. Excuse me, the jungles of Ecuador, South America. So that's pretty awesome. At the age of 12, they returned to the States and lived in Kansas. After he graduated from Kansas State University in 2005, he came to the Richmond area to stay with family. He is married to Laura Kohl, and they have two sons, Benaiah and Ethan, and a daughter, Cara. Michael has a great love for God and a passion for building his kingdom. That's God's kingdom, not Michael's kingdom, which led him to attend seminary. Reverend Kohl graduated from Baptist Theological Seminary of Richmond, Virginia, in May of 2012, where he received a Master's of Divinity. A month prior to receiving his MDiv, Reverend Kohl was ordained by Carlisle Avenue Baptist Church in Richmond on April 22, 2012. Michael began serving at Mulberry Grove Baptist Church after seminary, where he has served for the past 10 years. During his time at Mulberry Grove, he has served as moderator in their association, led a prison ministry to Spanish-speaking inmates, and yes, Reverend Kohl is bilingual, English and Spanish. He is the director of a mobile food bank and has coordinated many local community work projects. He is particularly in love with his family and spending time sharing life with them. The Kohls love to play games like board games, card games, sports, and anything that is outdoors, kayaking, disc golf, and hiking. Michael and Laura are both very active and love CrossFit exercise and obstacle races, and Michael has successfully completed 2 24-hour obstacle courses. Now, by successfully completed, he means he didn't die. Both Michael and Laura have trained and completed other ultra marathons together. Their oldest son, Benaiah, begins middle school this fall and is into football. He loves to play it and watch the NFL, and he particularly likes a certain person named Tom Brady. Ethan starts third grade this fall and has recently begun collecting Pokemon cards. And both boys are very active and love playing together. Cara is the little princess and loves everything girl, like princesses, pink, unicorns, and she's recently started ballet. She is looking forward to starting kindergarten in the fall, and all of the Kohls are very excited to make new friends and get connected into the community at Bedford. Welcome, Reverend Kohl, Laura, Benaiah, Ethan, and Cara. We're so happy to have you with us today.
Our call to worship this morning is Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, hymn number 295. Let's stand and sing the first verse only.
Let us go to God in prayer. Oh God, our Heavenly Father, we come before you today with great anticipation and excitement as we consider your servant, Reverend Michael Kohl, as our new pastor. We lift him and his family up before you, Lord, and pray your blessings upon them. We pray for your Holy Spirit to guide us and convict us as to the decision we will be making, and may it align, Father, with your holy will. We know through your precious word that you want to bless us and always to help us. We thank you, Father, for that promise, and we claim it today with joyful and hopeful hearts. Father, we ask this prayer in Jesus' gracious and loving name, and now we worship you in thanksgiving. It's in his name we offer up this time together. Amen.
O Worship the King, All Glorious Above, hymn number 52.
Invite our kids to come here to the front to join me. I was waiting for you to cue me. Come on up, guys and gals and girls and boys. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Hey, beautiful. All right. Well, it is so good to see so many this morning. What a treat. What a treat. Now, I've got a secret, but don't tell your parents. I'm still a big, big kid myself. They think they're hiring a pastor, but they're calling a big kid. I love to play with Legos. I've got so many Legos. If you were to weigh my Legos, it probably weighs more than the biggest kid here, except for me, except for me. I've got so many Legos. I've got boxes and boxes and boxes of Legos. And so one of the things I like to do is build Legos. I don't just look at them, I build them. So I've got this says once upon a brick, kind of like once upon a time. Have you guys ever heard that?
Yeah.
So you have? Well, I've got a once upon a time story, and it is a story that you guys know so well. I know you do. Do you guys know the story of David?
Yeah.
Only a boy named David?
Yeah.
Yes?
I know the song of it.
What is the song of it?
Only a boy named David.
Only a little sling. Only a boy named David, but he could pray and sing. Well, here's my David. Look at my David.
Whoa.
Oh, he lost his slingshot. So I had to put Silly Putty in his hand to make him hold his slingshot. You guys are going to have to use your imagination. Okay? That's his slingshot that fell out. So what this does, it's a pop-up Lego. So you close it.
And then you open it.
And Goliath fell. Let's put Goliath back.
He's already vanquished.
It's not just a book. It's a pop-up book. So Goliath hasn't fallen yet because we haven't told our story. So here's the armor bearer, and he's carrying the shield. And here's David, and you got to pretend he's got his slingshot in his hand. And I got a question. If David is going to shoot a rock out of his slingshot, why does this guy have the shield?
I'm going to say.
This guy's the armor bearer.
He's going to give it to Goliath.
But he never did. And so Goliath got popped in the head.
He didn't have time.
So the story is that little David trusted in God, right? And little David went, and Goliath was huge. He was so big.
Bigger than you.
Even bigger than me.
Even bigger than that light.
Yes, Goliath was huge. And he had all this armor. And but do you know what Goliath was?
What?
He was mean.
Yeah.
And he said some really mean things about God. And he said, I'm going to kill you. And David says, you're not. Because David, I trust in God.
And then David threw a slingshot, a rock.
He did. He used the slingshot. And the song goes, it went round and round and round and round and round and round and round. And one little stone went up, up, up. And the giant came tumbling down. You want to knock him over?
All fall down.
Boom! He's dead. So here's the story, though. Not just that Goliath died.
Oh, he broke.
Well, he did. He broke in half. So David trusted in God, right? He trusted in God that God would deliver him. And David said, you come to me with a sword and a spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord. So I'm going to be preaching later about David and Goliath. And I'm going to talk to the church about how sometimes the giants, they look big and scary, but when we're on God's side, we can trust God, and God delivers us. So what do you guys think about my son? Do you guys like the sun?
Uh-huh.
Well, it's kind of weird, but it does the job, okay? So that's my message for you guys, is to trust God, and God can deliver us, even though the giants sometimes seem really big and scary. Okay, so let's fold our hands together like this. That way I know you're not going to hit me when I'm praying and I got my eyes closed. Okay, and now we're going to close our eyes and we're going to pray to God. Okay? Father God, Lord, I thank you. I thank you for these boys and girls. And Lord, David was a young man or a young boy, and he trusted in you. And Lord, I pray that for my kids. I pray that for these kids, that they would trust you and not lean on their own strength, but look to you, Lord. And so I just thank you. I pray a blessing over the children here at Bedford. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the
amen. It wasn't until halfway through this prayer that I realized I was wearing a princess crown. I felt something on my head, and it was still there. It was a little princess crown. So thank you. You guys are blessed. I hope you know that. That was precious to see those kids. What a beautiful, beautiful thing. That's our future. That's your future. What a treat. I get to share with you my testimony, and I'm glad to. I'm really excited to get to know you. I'm really excited for you to get to know me. As the bio said, I'm born in Ecuador, South America, which makes me kind of strange, makes me a little different. Started a little late, so the culture thing is something I'm catching up with. I've been here in this country 28 years. You'd think I'd learn something by now. I was born to very godly parents, very godly grandparents, very godly great-grandparents. And so I'm what you'd call a second, third, fourth generation Christian. And so because of that, I was raised in the church. I was raised knowing God's word from a very, very young age. I was also, and this is going to sound really, really strange, I was cursed that I was a really well-behaved, very well-behaved child. And I say that, and I mean it, because I actually, as a very young age, felt like I did not need God. I was so much better than all my friends. They were misbehaving, and I never was. I never got in trouble. My parents were Christians. They were missionaries, for crying out loud. If I wasn't going to heaven, nobody was going to heaven, because I was so good. And because of that, I fought it. I fought accepting Christ for a very long time. And I do remember, I shared this in my testimony the other night. I remember believing that, but not quite believing it. Because I would run, and I would literally check to see if my parents were still here. Because as a good little Christian kid, I believed in the rapture. And so I knew that if they were still here, I still had time to accept Christ. But not yet. And so my mom pulled me aside one day. I was about 12. And she asked me if I'd ever consider accepting Christ. And I just remember being really upset and bothered. Like, Mom, I'm a good kid. I behave. I do well. Why? Like, just really being upset and bothered that she would dare talk to me about this thing called salvation, which is for the bad people. And started to realize and be real convicted that we are saved by grace and by grace only. Do we come to a faith in Christ? And so I realized that my good deeds, what's the Bible say? Our good works are like filthy rags. And my good deeds were not enough. I was a sinner, and I was damned to hell. And I knew that at the age of 12. And so I decided to put my faith in Jesus Christ at a young age of 12. And I did. I believed in Jesus. I loved Jesus. But I didn't make my commitment to follow, to serve, maybe is a better word, until about 14. At about 14, I decided that just being a Christian in name is no Christian at all. And so I decided at that time to start serving in the church in any capacity. I did Awanas. I led music in my church, the kids' music. Started serving at camp, which really paid dividends. I met my wife there, and very, very good investment on my return on my investment there. And so it's been a great journey for me. People often ask me about my call to ministry, and it didn't happen as an adult. My call came at 14, when the Lord imprinted on my heart the desire to serve and to serve him. So I did. I went through high school, college, went out to Richmond, Virginia, where I was in corporate for 5-6 years. And the Lord re-impressed on my heart this desire for ministry, this call in an official capacity. And so I touched bases with my wife at the time, Laura, who's here with us today. And I said, hey, kind of feeling led towards pastoral work, expecting her to not want to do it, so expecting her to say, no way, Jose. And she was on board. She was super excited about it. And so I went to the seminary there in Richmond, Baptist Theological Seminary of Richmond, and graduated in 2012, where I went to serve after graduation at Mulberry Grove Baptist Church, where I'm still a pastor today. And a beautiful, beautiful church in the middle of nowhere of Buckingham, Virginia. It is a lovely place, a lovely church, and I am glad to be serving there for the past 10 years. And so it's with a very heavy heart that I'm looking forward to being called here, but at the same time, just recognizing that I've got a lovely church family that is going to be a hard goodbye, but I'm excited for this relationship. So that kind of brings me to the present, where I've got a 10-year-old son, a 7-year-old son, and a 5-year-old girl, which I'm just so excited about. They're the joy. They're my joy. I think I identify first as a father, then as a pastor. Well, first as a husband. I love you. husband, pastor, father. I don't know. I'm going to get in trouble, but that's why I sit in the front, so she doesn't hit me until later. But yes, I'm very excited. I am very excited to be here with you guys. You guys have been very loving, very welcoming, very encouraging. And again, I'm looking forward to worshiping with you this morning. I'm looking forward to sharing just a little bit more of the message of David and Goliath with you this morning. And as Tanya dangled, I was actually expecting, where'd she go? As Tanya was saying that, I was expecting her to teach you because she learned so well last night. But again, I guess she dangled the carrot for you. So if you vote yes, I guess I'm on the hook to teach you as well. But again, there it is. So let me transition as we go to God in prayer. It's strange for me to pray a pastoral prayer as I'm just getting to know you guys. And so forgive me as I don't pray for you individually. I do know there's several on the prayer list as far as concerns go, as far as health goes. But I'd like to pray over you as a church. I'd like to pray over you in your discernment, in your processing the call this morning, your vote this morning. I certainly am biased, but I can still pray that the Lord would lead your heart and your conviction as you vote. But let's go to God this morning in prayer. Our Father and our God, our Abba, our Daddy, we come before you this morning, Lord. We just, as always, I ask, Lord, for your presence to be in this room, for your presence to open hearts, to open ears, to open minds, to hear your word, to worship through song, to worship through offering. And so, Lord, I pray for this church. I pray for Bedford Baptist Church. I pray a blessing over this church. They've been looking for a couple of years for new leadership, for a man to lead this church in fear, in trepidation, in reverence to you. And so, Lord, as they discern this morning, I pray for peace upon them. I pray that they would be able to, with full confidence, know what your will is for them. And so, Lord, I just pray a blessing over them as they have a business meeting after this service. I pray that your presence would continue throughout. I pray for me as I share the word. Lord, I pray that I would get out of the way, that your voice, your words, your conviction might speak through me, maybe encourage, maybe challenge. We'll have a little bit of good times too, Lord, but I pray that the glory, that the honor, that the praise would be towards you. And so, Lord, just hear the music, hear the songs, hear the prayers that go up this morning, Lord. We want to praise you. We want to honor you. We want to revere you. And so, Lord, I thank you. I pray for those who are not able to be here this morning, whether it be sick, whether it be the weather, whether it just be homebound ailments. Lord, I just pray a blessing over those. Thank you for those who have come. It's a blessing to see a full house. It's a blessing to see folks coming out and curiosity and excitement and just a desire to worship. And so, Lord, as I said, I just pray for your spirit to guide us, to be with us during this service. In the precious name of your Son, Jesus.
Join together and sing Day by Day, hymn number 72. Let's stand.
Day by day, at every passing moment, strengthen my mind to meet my trials here. Shall we pray? Father God, we come to you this morning, eager to offer our work, our purses, and our praise. Thank you for the excitement in anticipation of this new day and new week. We wonder, who will you place in our paths? Where will we find an unexpected door through which we can carry your good news? Who will walk with us? With hearts full of thanksgiving, we wish to give our lives over to you this day, submitting our wills to your own and releasing our agendas into your hands. Allow us to experience the freedom, peace, and joy that comes from letting go. And when we are all spent, allow us to borrow the patience, kindness, and love necessary to go the extra mile, creating loving relationships with our neighbors and within our own families. Allow us to observe the needs of others so we may serve as your hands. We know that one step today can be the start of something great when we hold on to you. Please accept our offerings and make them beautiful. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Thank you.
One of the joys of getting to meet you guys is kind of get an expectation of what you want out of this. And I met Trouble yesterday, and she gave me two criteria. We'll skip the first one, but the second one was 12 o'clock. So we'll make sure we hit that one. I've got more control of that one. So, we're going to be in 1 Samuel 17, but it is so familiar. I do want you to turn there if you have a Bible, because I'm going to be pecking from there. But it's a long passage, and so I'm going to tell you the story because you know the story. You know the story so well. You were raised with it. You were taught it. But I'm going to probably go a completely different direction than you've been before. Maybe not. Maybe you've been this way. Maybe not, and I'll try to remember to turn around every now and then, but then you guys are front row. It's a little close. Okay, let's turn back around. That scared me too, okay? Only a boy named David, a little child. That's how the story goes, right? A little boy against a giant of a man. Poor little David. My message is actually going to be quite the opposite. I'm going to argue that David was in fact the overwhelming favorite from the very first step he took on the battlefield. David and Goliath has become synonymous in our culture with the underdog, right? And David is always the underdog. The little guy is by far the overwhelming minority. But I'm going to make three points to you this morning. And I believe that any one of these points puts Goliath at a disadvantage. Any one of these points was enough to where David was going to win from the very beginning. And when you put all three of these together, poor little Goliath never had a chance. He was outgunned, outnumbered, outclassed from the moment he stepped foot on the field. So the story goes like this. A little boy, probably more of a youth, probably more of a man, but whatever. A little tiny boy grabs a few rocks, goes into the battlefield. They offer him the best equipment. He says, no, I don't want that stuff because I'm going to trust in the Lord. Gets a rock, hits Goliath. Goliath falls, and wah, everybody wins, right? Is that what you were raised with? That's what I was raised with. David took five rocks. Why did he take five rocks? Well, preacher, he had four brothers. Goliath did. And so David took five rocks because he wanted to kill Goliath and his four brothers. Okay, that works for me. Because David was very confident in this endeavor. So I don't know if this goes exactly in chronological order, but in my Bible, 1 Samuel 16 is where Samuel comes and anoints David. Anoints David to be king over Israel. And so I do believe that David and Goliath happens after this anointing. I'm not a biblical scholar, but I do know 16 comes before 17. And that's good enough for me. It really is. I have not asked the experts of Bible history, but I do believe that God has chosen David. So if God has chosen David, if God has anointed David, if God has blessed David, and David knows this, then when David goes to confront the lions, the tigers, the bears, oh my, then David knows he's got this promise, right? And so if God is on David's side, I feel sorry for anybody who's fighting against them. So my first point is this, that God has already committed to David. God, the creator of all the universe, God, the sustainer of all things, has already chosen David for bigger and greater things. I don't think poor little Goliath even knew that. He had no idea that David was, in fact, God's chosen. So Goliath is entering into a fight that he has no chance at all. The earth could have opened its mouth and swallowed Goliath. David could have called fire from heaven. I don't know. But God could have figured out a way for David to win no matter what else happened with God on our side. Paul says something similar. Now, this is a few thousand years later. But Paul says something similar in Romans 8. He says, if God is with us, then who could ever be against us? Romans 8:31. Paul gets this. Now again, I get the timing is a little off. But Paul in the New Testament gets this. He says, you know, if God is with us, I pity our enemies. I do, like poor little Goliath. So my first point, and I would argue that if I didn't have points 2 and 3, this is good enough. Poor little Goliath never had a chance because God was on David's side. My second point, poor little Goliath brought a knife to a gunfight. So I think we think the story goes, this little tiny kid got a tiny toy and got lucky and threw a rock, and the Lord guided that rock right where it needed to be. I don't actually think that's how it went down. Again, we picture a child, we picture a kid, and he was young, but everybody expected David to fight hand-to-hand combat. So back in the good old days, Wayne, you were around back then, you had three kinds of fighting, Wayne. You had hand-to-hand combat, that's called melee, where you have swords, spears, maces, you have the, you weren't there? No lying. We're on the pulpit, it's not lying, it's embellishing, okay? Take that out of the recording. When you got me off. Hand-to-hand combat, melee combat. Then you had archery, artillery. You had the stuff that threw things, catapults. You had arrows. You had even spears, as long as you're throwing them. And then the third one is mounted cavalry. And each one is kind of designed to fight the other in a different way. Everybody expected David to go hand to hand. Goliath, on multiple occasions, says, come down and have hand-to-hand combat with me. If you've got your Bibles, you can peek. It's in verse 9, 10, 44, 48. Each time says, come and engage in battle with me. Even Saul expected David to have hand-to-hand combat. We see that in verse 38 and 39. He's trying to give him armor to fight hand-to-hand combat. Well, David, he didn't say this. The Bible doesn't say this, but I can kind of picture David saying, are you serious? Have you seen that guy? You expect me to fight him hand-to-hand? No way. No way. This is what I'm used to, and he's got his sling. Now, we speak as if he's got a little tiny slingshot. My kids have slingshots. They go out and play, and they shoot birds if they can. And we think of a toy. We think of a toy. But David had a weapon. A weapon. In Judges, I don't have this in the outline, but in Judges chapter 20, verse 16, we're hearing about these Benjamites, these men from the tribe of Benjamin, and they are so accurate with the slingshot, with a sling, that they could hit, it says, a hair, and I don't actually get the measurement, but it's far away. It's far away. Super pinpoint accurate, and these were weapons of war. David has successfully killed lions and bears with this slingshot. This is not a toy. The Bible says in, where's the verse? In verse 49, the stone that David shoots sinks into Goliath's head. Like it sinks into his skull. Like we're not talking about a toy. We're talking about a precise weapon of killing. Like this is a big gun. Now, I ask the question, if you've got a skinny little kid versus a huge giant, and the skinny little kid's got a 44 Magnum, I'm going to bet on the kid, especially if the kid's got some training, right? And so poor little Goliath, he brought a knife to a gunfight. David knew what he was doing. David knew full well how to use a sling. The other piece is interesting. Is Goliath, has an armor bearer. The armor bearer is in front of him with the shield. The Bible never says the armor bearer is like, hey, here's your shield. He's got a slingshot. Poor Goliath didn't even see it coming. Had no chance. He was not prepared for a gunfight. So if David brought a gun to a knife fight and Goliath brought a knife to a gunfight, poor little Goliath never had a chance. And did I mention that God is on David's side? This poor guy. Something's wrong. Number three, something is actually wrong with Goliath. It doesn't say this, but I'm going to allude to this. The Bible says that Goliath is led onto the field by his armor bearer. It says it two different times in two different verses, verse 7 and verse 41. Goliath follows the armor bearer onto the field, and I wonder why. I wonder why. I don't think Goliath is scared. I don't think they're dragging Goliath. I get the impression Goliath is fully confident and competent in fighting. But Goliath is led. The Bible says over and over again how slowly Goliath moved on the field. It says Goliath moved slowly towards David while David quickly ran towards Goliath. Goliath says, David, come to me. Well, he didn't say David. Young man, come to me. Come to me to fight. Something's wrong with Goliath. Now, I'm not a doctor, but I'm a pastor. So that means I trifle just enough to make it sound like I'm smart, but I don't really know what I'm talking about. So in humans today, there's a specific thing in your brain that when you're growing, my kid is growing almost every day, you're growing. At some point, something clicks and it says, hey, you're good. Stop growing. Well, there's a thing. There's a benign tumor that some people get that will basically grow in your brain and stop that trigger. So you don't stop growing. You continue to grow. And it's known as giantism. The benign tumor is called acromegaly. You actually can look this up. So acromegaly is that thing in your brain, that a tumor in your brain that prevents you from stopping growing. Does that make sense? Two negatives equal a positive. And so, for example, you guys know Andre the Giant, for you history buffs, before my time. But Andre the Giant had giantism. He had a benign tumor in his head that prevented him from growing. And it caused him to, it prevented him from stopping growing. So it caused him to keep growing. Most giants today that we'd consider giants have a benign tumor called acromegaly. Well, with acromegaly, with this tumor, one of the most common side effects is vision impairment. You have a harder time seeing. Look it up, folks. I'm telling the truth. You have a trouble seeing. And so Goliath is led onto the field. I wonder, it doesn't say this in the Bible. Please hear that clearly. I wonder if he struggled with his eyesight. He's led onto the field. He moves slowly. The Bible does, in fact, say that when he sees David, he says, "Why are you coming at me with sticks?" The Hebrew word for sticks is the plural word for sticks, like our English word for sticks. I think that's in verse 48, 43, somewhere in that neighborhood, 43. Goliath said, "Sticks. You're coming at me with sticks." I wonder if Goliath could see very well. So now we've got David bringing a gun to a knife fight. We've got the armor bearer still holding the shield that could potentially block said object being thrown at him. And we've got a guy who can't see very well. I wonder how he was expecting to dodge a bullet if he couldn't see very well. So poor little Goliath had a physical disability. He brought a knife, and he didn't have the Lord on his side. David had won the battle way before he'd ever even stepped foot. I do, to the bottom of my heart, I feel that Goliath was at a disadvantage from the very, very beginning. So let's go with our conclusion, because I'm looking at my 12 o'clock. With God, all things are possible. When we are on the winning side, when we are fighting for the Lord, when we are serving the Lord, all things are possible. Conclusion number two, we are perfectly equipped to handle anything the world throws at us. In David's case, he brought a sling. In our case, I don't have here we go. It's a hymn book. Pretend with me. We have the Word of God. I think there is one right here. No, there isn't. All right, we have the Word of God on our iPhones. We have the Word of God at our fingertips. The Word of God says that it will help us with all things. It'll guide us in anything for godliness. It'll teach us, instruct us. We have the Word of God at our fingertips. And when we use the Word of God, when we turn to God's Word, we can, in fact, handle anything the world has to throw our direction. And then my final conclusion, and then we'll sum it all up. Sometimes our giants aren't quite as big and scary as they appear. So we see these giants, we see these obstacles, and we are terrified. We're so scared. We say, "Oh, well, that's so big, and I'm so little." We are so scared. We are like the people of Israel standing on the sidelines, too scared to even try. Not knowing that the minute we step foot on the battlefield, the war's already over. We are the favorites, and yet we are so scared ourselves. Guys, with God, anything is possible. We just sometimes don't pray big enough, don't we? With God, anything is possible. We have everything we need in God's Word. Everything we need to approach God with boldness. Jesus talks about the access, Paul does. We talk about this access we have towards God. And it's because of Jesus. It's because of God's Word. We are in a special place where every one of you has the access to God's Word every day. And as I said, sometimes our giants aren't as big and scary as they initially seem. So my whole conclusion is this. Sometimes we don't pray big enough. Sometimes we don't pray big enough. If we look at our prayer life tends to be asking God, I haven't forgotten about you guys, asking God to make our obstacles smaller. Think of somebody doing high jump. Think of somebody doing hurdles. We pray that God would lower the bar so that we can get over it. We pray that God would make our life easier, more comfortable. Our prayers tend to be, you know, God, protect me from bad things happening. Nothing wrong with that prayer, folks. Nothing wrong for me praying to my kids that they'd be healthy, that they'd be good, that they'd behave in school, right? But when that's all we know how to pray, when we only know how to ask God to make my life simpler, instead of saying, you know, here's a giant. Instead of asking God to lower the bar, we should pray that God would make us equipped, that God would give us the strength to overcome our obstacles. Rather than God taking away our struggles, that God would help us rise to the occasion, rise to the occasion to answer God's call. In my experience, almost every time, the times that I'm darkest, deepest, struggling the most are the times that I'm closest to God. And yet, in my prayer life, I tend to pray that God would take those away. Instead of me praying that God would use me to fight the giants, I want God to make the giants smaller. I pray for boldness. I pray that we would see the story of David and Goliath as an encouragement that, yes, the world is scary, but God's got a place for us. God's got a place for you as an individual. God's got a place for you as a church. I'm not going to get political, but I think God has a place for us as a nation. I think God has a place for us as Baptists across the world. I think that we just don't dream big enough. Do you think David was scared when he got on the field? I'm sure he was. I don't think he's crazy. But I think David has the confidence to know that he knew that he knows that God is on his side. So Christian, let me encourage you. Let me challenge you to start praying David-sized prayers. The Bible calls David a man after God's own heart. And David was a mess. Hear that clearly. David was a mess, but he had a heart for the Lord. David knew how to pray God-sized prayers. David had the confidence to step onto the field. Poor little Goliath. I don't think he ever saw it coming. So let me encourage you and let me challenge you, Christian. Let's look to God. Let's pray to God a different prayer. Let's change our perspective. Our perspective of fear and trembling to boldness in him. David did not come and say, I'm going to beat you because I'm awesome. The Lord, the one who you are cursing, Goliath, is going to take you down. And I've got full confidence in that. Our God is in the business of doing incredible things. And he has called you. Let's go to him in prayer. Our Father and our God, I thank you. I do. You are a powerful, awesome God. It is a privilege to serve. And so, Lord, I thank you for the story of David and Goliath. I thank you for his testimony of boldness, his testimony of faith. Lord, I pray that for Bedford. I pray that for this congregation here, that we would change perspective away from fear, away from paralysis, that we would speak and move boldly as we follow you. And so, Lord, I pray that. I lift up this congregation. I pray for a change in perspective, that we would turn in faith towards you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Our hymn of commitment this morning is number 509, Trust in the Lord. If you feel called to join Bedford Baptist Church, we would invite you to come forward. We accept new members on profession of faith in Christ, by transfer of letter of membership, and by sharing your previous Christian experience. Let's stand and sing together.
Amen. Well, I'm going to close with a benediction, but obviously we're going to continue with the business meeting. So it's kind of a closing prayer and yet not, because I do certainly want the Lord's Spirit to still be with you as you have your business meeting. But let's close with a benediction together. Our Father, our God, I pray a blessing over Bedford Baptist. I pray that you would go with each as they travel home, as they continue in just a minute a business meeting. Lord, I always ask that you would continue. Lord, business is hopefully always done to glorify and honor you. And so, Lord, I pray your presence to continue as they discern, as they vote. Lord, I just pray that it would be something that would glorify and honor you. And so go with each member, each person, each family gathered here this morning. Go with each as they travel home in the rain. Be with them in safety. Bless them, Lord. I pray that the word spoken this morning would have encouraged. I pray that the worship they were able to sing would also have lifted their souls. And so just pray a blessing over each one. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Reverend Kohl, for sharing what the Lord had placed upon your heart for Bedford Baptist Church to hear today. You may be seated. First, a word of welcome to our visitors. The choir is going to come forward and take a seat in the sanctuary. If anybody in the balcony